Thank you for coming. Welcome to NATO's 38th annual conference. We will be starting in about 1 minute. Before we begin, we want to cover a few housekeeping items. On your attendee screen, you can enter comments in the chat and questions in the Q&A. We hope you will take advantage of this opportunity to engage with our speakers and attendees. This session is being recorded. We recognize and thank the California Healthcare Foundation for being our petabyte sponsor. Information about all conference sponsors is available in the sponsor area of the platform. Please take a few minutes to visit each sponsor's booth where you can find information about them and find game tokens. Game tokens are keywords or phrases used in the token hunt game for a chance to win a prize in our daily drawings. Now, let me turn the stage over to Charles Holly, NATO's Director of Projects. Charles?
Thank you, Erica, and thank you all for being here. We're excited to introduce the session addressing data gaps and identifying new sources of data. And I also wanted to say thank you to this session's sponsor, Freedman Healthcare. And then I will introduce to you all our moderator for today's session, Tanya Bernstein. And thank you for joining us, Tanya. I'll give you the floor.
Thank you, Charles. Hi, everyone, and welcome to today's NATO session entitled Addressing Data Gaps and Identifying New Sources of Data. At Freedman Healthcare, we know that the ability of health databases to provide meaningful insights into our healthcare system and the health of populations rests firmly on the quality of the underlying data itself. To build credibility in the programs that many of us work so tirelessly to support, we must first build trust in the data. And the most important way to do that is to continuously work on the data quality and its completeness. Today, you'll hear from three presenters about this very topic, data quality and data completeness. These presenters have developed novel ways to review, improve, and augment the quality of the data they collect and process. And we at Freedman Healthcare are excited to have them share their work and lessons learned with all of you. As we listen to the presentation, let's keep in mind that data quality and data completeness constantly evolve. There will always be new ideas regarding this topic, new ways to fill the gaps, new ways to QA our work, new data sources and data elements to augment what we already collect. Of course, this is especially true as state agencies and other stakeholders continue to evolve the ways they use the data, continue to identify new business needs and use cases, which will invariably highlight additional data deficiencies, which will benefit from our creative resolutions. While this may seem frustrating at times, and I know it's been frustrating to me, let's all recognize that the single best way to improve the quality of our data is to use it. And the more data quality approaches that we all come up with and talk about today and in the coming years, the better. It means our programs are maturing and that the value of these data are being realized. So with that, we at Freedman Healthcare welcome you to today's presentation. We are very excited to get started. Our first presenter today, our first presentation will be from Babak Fard of the University of Nebraska Medical Center, whose team developed a new data validation tool. Babak, I turn the floor over to you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Babak Fard, an environmental data scientist at the University of Nebraska Medical Center and a member of Nebraska Environmental Public Health Tracking Team. In this presentation, I will talk shortly about our recently started involvement in the CDC's National Environmental Public Health Tracking Program and our experience submitting our first data call in summer 2023. The tracking program is a pivotal initiative that bridges the gap between environmental data and public health. The program collects and validates data through its seasonal data calls, ensuring its accuracy and reliability. This process aids communities in making well-informed decisions to address various environmental health challenges. In today's rapidly changing health landscape, the importance of data-driven decisions cannot be overstated. The tracking program stands as a testament to this. Its mission is clear: to harness the power of integrated health and environmental data to drive actions that improve community health. By synthesizing vast amounts of data, the tracking network addresses critical information needs identified through extensive user testing and stakeholder involvement. Upon receiving the raw datasets for our water data call, we realized that using an in-house data validation tool that checks our finalized data against the provided data dictionary and how to guide can be very helpful. We therefore chose the best tools for it and created our data validation tool that proved to be helpful. Validation serves as the gatekeeper in the realm of data processing and analysis. It ensures that our submitted data meets predefined criteria and standards, acting as a primary defense against inaccuracies. Think of it as quality control for data. Just as a manufacturing process has checks to ensure product quality, data validation ensures the quality and reliability of data. With this crucial step, we avoid introducing errors into our datasets, which can lead to flawed analysis and subsequently flawed decisions. In the context of public health, where decisions can impact entire communities, the importance of data validation becomes even more pronounced. Ensuring data integrity is not just a technical necessity, it's a responsibility to ensure that our conclusions and actions are based on accurate and trustworthy information. Participating in the tracking data call for the first time presented its own set of challenges: navigating the general process, understanding the data dictionaries, and adhering to the how-to guides were initial hurdles. Collaborating with various data providers to ensure data accuracy and format compatibility added another layer of complexity. However, the unwavering support from the tracking program and our data providers were invaluable in guiding us through these challenges. Despite the guidance, it was imperative to strictly adhere to the data structures outlined in the data dictionaries. Any deviation could lead to potential data rejection, emphasizing the critical nature of this step. To ensure our dataset met the necessary criteria before submission, we crafted specialized validation libraries. Our inaugural library focused on the water quality and community water system data calls. This library and those we plan for the future encompass three core functionalities. Firstly, it integrates all data rules outlined by the water data dictionaries. Secondly, it offers automatic checks and, where feasible, corrections for reference fields like county FIPS codes. Lastly, it generates a comprehensive report detailing potential validation discrepancies, ensuring clarity and accuracy in our datasets. We chose Python for our data validation endeavors, and here's why. Python is more than just a programming language. It's a versatile tool that seamlessly bridges the realm of data science and public health. Its capabilities are further enhanced by a plethora of specialized libraries, each designed to cater to specific applications. Moreover, the extensive Python community continually contributes to its growth, fostering innovation and collaboration. We opted for Pydantic for our data validation, not only for its robust capabilities in ensuring data integrity, but also for its versatility in web applications. Pydantic seamlessly integrates with Python's type annotations, offering precise validation for complex data structures. Its detailed error messages guide us to data discrepancies, ensuring clarity. Moreover, its adaptability in web and API development positions it as a forward-thinking choice. In summary, Pydantic's structured approach guarantees our dataset's accuracy while also paving the way for future web-based endeavors. Now let's take a quick look at some sections of the code and a sample of a validation process. Here you can see part of our PWS inventory class, which takes care of validating public water system inventories. As you can see, it inherits from base model class of pydantic library. Here, each attribute conforms to each field of the PWS inventory dataset and with the different validation rules. For example, an ID number should start with a state code followed with 7 digits, or the year pulled for the data should be an integer value between 1999 and 2023. Moreover, we have added another layer of validation. Here you can see in this function, it controls that the provided FIPS codes from data providers actually matches the real FIPS codes. For doing that, for when one is making an instance of the class, should give it the list of the county FIPS codes. But how to do that? We thought about that also. In our general library, we have provided this specific function that someone can call with giving the specific code of their state. The code then goes into the Census Bureau website, extracts the FIPS codes, and only sorts the FIPS and county names for that specific state. And here you can see a small sample of validation. We have created a dictionary of invalid rows. Then we loop over each row of our data set and test it against our created validation library. For those who cannot pass the validation, they are added into the invalid rows dictionary, which you can see a part of it. The key of each element is the row identifier, and the value contains the error message. Therefore, one can extract using row identifier those specific rows which have problems and work on them. This presentation showcases the foundational steps we've taken to establish a precise and expandable data preparation framework for seamless submissions to the tracking data calls. Emphasizing collaboration, we believe that by openly sharing our tools and methodologies, we can collectively enhance data validation processes across the board. This isn't just about refining data submissions, it's about leveraging accurate data to drive better public health decisions and outcomes. We remain hopeful as we continue refining our validation capabilities. Our collaborative efforts, in tandem with other tracking recipient states, aim to significantly elevate public health outcomes for a brighter and healthier future. In the end, I'd like to acknowledge my team from both Department of Health and Human Services of Nebraska and also the University of Nebraska Medical Center. And with that, I would be happy to answer your question.
Thank you so much, Babak. That was great. If anyone from the audience has any questions, you can put them in the chat and we'll ask them either now or at the end of the presentation. And so I'll keep an eye out for that. But Babak, one of the things that your presentation included that was particularly interesting was the development of this verification validation library. Can you tell us a little bit more about who you consulted, who your team consulted, what stakeholders were involved in developing that library of validation steps?
Sure. So we basically, our team is a team, our team and the Nebraska Department of Health, HHS of Nebraska. But it depends on different data set. For example, here for this specific data set, because it was water quality, we have also someone from Nebraska Department of Environment and Energy who was giving us guidance specifically on these water quality systems. And it depends on, based on different data sets. The fixed parts are us and the Nebraska Department of Health, HHS, but then based on different data sets which may come, then different groups may be involved as stakeholders.
Thank you. That's very interesting. I also appreciated at the end of the presentation where you talked about wanting to kind of share with others and you know, collaborate on additional validations. Are there specific types of organizations that your team is looking to collaborate with and share?
We have actually, we have right now, we have it on a GitHub repository, which is publicly available. Everyone can check that. And we might in the future present it in one of those because the tracking program, they continually, they have these sessions that different states can present their products. We might be thinking about that also, maybe when we add more libraries, make it more mature in different sense, then we definitely present it there.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. If anyone has any questions, continue to put them into the chat and we'll get to them at the end of all three of our presentations. Thank you. So let's move to our second group of presenters today. We have Chris Dalton and Alice Aguirre from CIVIC, which is the Center for Improving Value in Healthcare in Colorado. And they are going to describe their new Submitter Quality Index that they've developed. So let's take a look at that presentation.
Welcome to my presentation on the Submitter Quality Index. My name is Chris Dalton, and today I will be going over various aspects of the Submitter Quality Index that was created by CIVIC, and I will be referring to this as the SQI throughout the presentation. For a brief overview of why we decided to create an SQI, we determined there was a need to score the data in the COAPCD. This is performed in addition to our data quality checks that we perform when at the intake, when we get data from our payers. The SQI scores the process data that we were going to be using in our analysis. We wanted an easy to understand score. That's why our score is out of 10. We wanted to choose various important fields to measure, and we've been producing the SQI scores for over a year now. And as of fiscal year 24, the SQI scoring is now used as a key performance indicator. And finally, continuous updates are being made. These will be implemented in fiscal year 25. In addition, we plan to continue updating the SQI for each fiscal year. What are some of the benefits of the SQI? It helps us identify potential data quality issues that may have come through intake that were not caught by our current checks for the intake. If a field score is really low, we can run that field by payer code to further investigate and reach out to the payer if needed. We can track scores over time. Ideally, the scores will show improvement from a previous run of the SQI. This is going to be indicating that our data submissions are improving. It gives us higher confidence in the analysis produced. A higher COAPCD score from the SQI indicates that quality data is being submitted from the payers. And finally, it shows the health of the COAPCD. This is why the score is out of 10. We want our score to be at a 9 or above. This gives us a lot of confidence that we are using high quality data. For the methodology on how we built the SQI, we started by, we wanted to generate scores for three files we received from our payers. These are the medical claims file, the pharmacy claims file, and our member eligibility file. And for each of those files, we chose between 23 and 26 important fields. These fields are chosen because based on their high use in our analysis, and they're required by our data submission guide. So all of our payers have to submit these fields. And some of these fields are service start date, paid amount, place of service, eligibility month and year. Fields are measured by the number of invalids and nulls. So we have two checks on how we, for the data. Invalids are values that fall outside of a given range or code set. For example, place of service codes that are outside of the code set produced by CMS would be considered invalid. eligibility dates in the future, such as greater than 2023, would also be considered invalid, or dates that are in the far past, such as dates that are before the COAPCD was created. We wanted to set the date range to be consistent between nulls and invalids. Originally, we started with 2017 to the current, and we've updated that to a rolling 4 refreshes as of July 2023. Each field is scored based on the number of invalids or nulls. Fields that have a maximum, that have all values present, have a maximum score of 5. After we score each of the fields for that file type are summed, and then they are averaged to get a null or invalid score out of 5 for each of those files. And finally, once we have each score out of 5 for each of the files and for each of the checks for null or invalid, we add those scores together to get a score out of 10 for that total file. And finally, to create our overall COAPCD score, all 3 of those file scores out of 10 are averaged, and that's our overall score out of 10. Some of the challenges we faced when creating the SQI are, what are we considering important fields? Out of all the required fields from the DSG, which of those are critical to our analysis? We had a little issue or trouble on determining a refresh schedule of the SQI and the date range that we wanted to use so we could show improvement. We were thinking between all years of the COAPCD or just specific years. So we decided on 2017 to current for our first iteration of this. And we also want to determine what our refresh schedule was going to be for the SQI. Did we want to do it after each refresh of our data warehouse, which occurs bi-monthly, or did we want to do it quarterly? And ultimately, we decided to do it after each refresh of the data warehouse. And determining what we wanted to consider invalid values. And to start, we wanted to see, you know, for example, eligibility and service dates that are not too early or in the future. We found that sometimes the years were submitted as 1900 for eligibility. So we wanted to exclude those as, or classify those as invalid, or as I mentioned, field values that fall greater than 2023 would also be considered invalid. And we wanted to make sure all of our valid values are captured. So like I mentioned, the code set produced by CMS for the place of service, we wanted to make sure all of those values were included. Other examples would be code sets that are designated by our DSG. So we want to make sure that all of the values we're asking payers to submit are in there, and those are going to be considered valid values when we do the scoring. For our fiscal year 24 enhancements, as I mentioned, we changed the date to do the last rolling last 4 refreshes. This allows for a more dynamic score and really focuses on the new COAPCD data we're getting, whereas the 2017 to current version we were using, it was a little harder to see changes in the scoring because it was going back pretty far. It still had its benefits of showing the overall health of the APCD for a wide range of data and years. But we changed it because we wanted to see improvements in submissions that where we couldn't really see that with a big year range. Using a rolling 4 refresh, we can see that field scores are improving. We added a weighting system. Fields that are always 100% are weighted less than the fields where the score fluctuates. We've determined the fields that where the field scores fluctuate by running the SQI and keeping an eye on which fields were not always scoring 100%. So we want to make sure by adding the weighting system that we have a little more impact for those fields where the score is fluctuating so we can see improvement. We added demographic fields now for this version of the SQI. As I mentioned, new fields will be added each fiscal year to reflect DSG updates. So we'll implement those in fiscal year 25 or 26, et cetera, when there are new fields added that are required for payers. We added some more comprehensive logic for the invalid checks. So for example, where we had the eligibility date being greater than 2023, we've also added in a check to make sure the eligibility month is between 1 and 12 and not something like 22 or 33. And as I mentioned at the beginning, the SQI is now used as a key performance indicator for us. That's the end of my presentation. Thank you for attending and enjoy the rest of NATO.
Great. Thank you so much, Chris and Alice. What a cool thing. I've never seen anything like it. Can you talk a little bit more about who sees the SQI and specifically whether payers or submitters see their scores?
Yeah. Right now, it's just used internally within Civic as we're continuing to refine it. And we do have plans in the future to share this with payers and send them their scores.
Got it. Thank you. And then I couldn't help but notice that you don't run it against the provider file. And I was wondering why that was, if it was a conscious decision or that's part of your upcoming plan for the future.
We decided not to use it against the provider file just because we didn't think there was enough information there to really have like a great SQI score off of it. Let's see. Yeah, I'm hearing the background noise too. Oh, there we go. We decided not to use the provider one because it kind of varies a little bit in like the number of provider information we're getting, and we just found that it was more relevant towards like medical claims, pharmacy claims, and the member eligibility.
Great. Thank you so much. And then one more question. Looks like we received. So you mentioned right now you're using this score internally only. Have you noticed that it has improved the quality of submissions by making your internal team more conscious, more aware of the issues, or you haven't realized that kind of benefit yet?
We've noticed some improvements in it since we run it after every refresh. We've noticed that we've had some gains in some of the fields where we were having some fluctuations in the scores. So we've definitely seen some real world results from our scores and how it's improving the data.
Thank you. Thank you so much. If anyone has any other questions, I'll go ahead and put them in the chat. And let's move on to our third and final presentation, which is from Dolores Yanagihara and Jesse Drummond from the Integrated Health Association and On Point Health Data, respectively, who will describe their new methodology to identify primary care practices.
Morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are. I'm Dolores Yanagihara with Integrated Healthcare Association in California, and I'm joined today by Jesse Drummond with On Point Health Data in Maine to talk about creating provider rosters with claims data. I'd like to start by providing some context and information about the use case for this work to develop a claims algorithm for identifying primary care practices. Next slide, please. The work we did was in the context of the California Advanced Primary Care Initiative, or CAPSI. CAPSI is a collaboration of seven payers that voluntarily came together in 2022 and signed a non-binding memorandum of understanding, committing to work together through the end of 2025 to strengthen primary care. This collaboration was convened and is managed by IHA and the California Quality Collaborative. CAPSI is focused on specific areas. First, increasing investments and improving performance in primary care. We're measuring and reporting both primary care spending and performance on an agreed-upon advanced primary care measure set. Second, we developed a value-based payment primary care payment model, which includes a hybrid of both capitation and fee-for-service payments, as well as performance-based payments, with the intention that this model will increase payments to the participants in the primary care practices. As part of the payment model, we are promoting primary care physician selection or matching and the expectation of population health management, even for PPO populations that haven't traditionally required this. And lastly, CAPC is supporting care transformation through providing technical assistance and tools, including team care, integration of behavioral health, and focus on health equity. CAPC is focused on the primary care practice level, but this is challenging because there is no established way to identify a practice and claims. So Jesse will now talk about the work we did to address this.
Yeah, thank you, Dolores. So this brings us nicely to our goal for this project, and that was to develop a claims-based methodology to identify primary care practices and attribute providers to those practices. So I'll talk about our process for developing that methodology, describe some details about the methodology, talk about the results of some of our performance testing, set up a couple next steps, and then I'll pass it back to Dolores to talk about some of the quality results we've been able to generate using this methodology. So we began with some exploratory analyses. We prepared a data set that included 2 years of primary care claims, and we evaluated the availability and completeness of key provider fields, as well as the relationships among some of those fields. We primarily used claims and enrollment information. We also used address and name information from NPES, a national provider registry. And of note here, we know that most California plans use TIN to contract with practices. We didn't have that available to us, so we're using primarily the NPIs, and specifically the billing NPI, to identify a practice. Now, as a part of this work, we convened a stakeholder group that included providers, analytics subject matter experts, as well as representatives from provider organizations and health plans, and they were instrumental right from the very beginning in our development of the methodology, also reviewing the testing results, and ultimately approving our approach. So we then did the methodology development, and we performed 2 rounds of performance testing that I'll talk about in a few minutes, where we did a formal roster review against rosters that were provided by the provider organizations and the plans. So more on that in a minute, but first let's talk about the methodology itself. So we began with the first of really 2 steps. The first was a member to provider attribution step, and there's a lot of flavors of this out there. We chose to do a combination of enrollment information with claims information to identify the provider who provided the most services in that 2-year range to each member. And then we got to the provider to practice attribution piece. And for this, as I mentioned earlier, we identified practices using the billing NPI. And our first step was capturing all the relationships between the rendering providers to the practices, to the billing NPIs. So we mapped each rendering provider to all the NPIs to which they bill. We also mapped each rendering provider to any organization NPI that shares a physical address, as reported in NPES. So each NPI in NPES is identified either as an individual or an organization. And one thing we found in our some of our initial analyses was that in some practices, some providers were only billing to other providers in their practice, not to an organization NPI. And we wanted to make sure to capture those relationships. So once we had all of those mappings, we identified a single billing NPI or organization for each rendering provider. Now, we know that providers can practice at multiple locations. For this pilot project, we were focused on identifying just one for each one. And so for that, we took a sort of 3-step hierarchical approach. We attributed each provider to the organization NPI to which they bill most frequently. If a provider didn't have any of those relationships, we attributed them to the organization that shared their same physical address as reported in NPES. And then from there, others who didn't fall into those buckets, attributed to the individual NPI to which they bill most frequently. And what this set up was a 1-to-1-to-1 relationship from the member to the provider to the practice. Now I'm going to show a few results here. So first, let's talk about this table. So what the table shows, just at a high level, is the number of practices we identified. We identified about 11,000 practices, many of which were adult or mixed, but some pediatrics as well. There's a wide range of members and providers, including a lot of solo practitioners. And now I'll direct your attention back to the top of the slide. There are 2 key findings here. One is that the billing NPI aligned fairly well with the roster definitions of practices. So for this first round, this was a valid approach for us. And then finally, we identified and were able to map 76% of providers who appeared on a practice roster. So about 76% of those relationships from provider to practice, we were able to map using our methodology. So I'm going to go here and talk about a few limitations and future directions. One is that we know that there are some provider types who don't appear in the claims at all. And so we won't be able to map those relationships. So specifically NPs and PAs may not appear in the claims. We also know that there are many provider to practice relationships, right? As I mentioned earlier, we know providers can practice in multiple locations. There were many of these relationships that we could see in the claims, but we excluded because of that one-to-one provider to practice relationship. So one future direction that we're considering is exploring relaxing that restriction and attributing members directly to a practice, and then from there attributing them to a provider within that practice. That way we can have providers in multiple practices. That will increase our capture rate. And then additionally, we have identified that there are many organizations that have multiple different billing NPIs. And so we're going to explore grouping by the organization name to try to include all of those together into a single level of detail. So with that, I'm going to pass it back to Dolores to talk about some of the quality results.
Great. Thank you so much, Jesse. We used the practice algorithm that Jesse just talked about and applied it to do practice level performance results on the advanced primary care measure set for the commercial population in California. And the measure set included clinical quality, utilization, and cost measures. This table summarizes the results. I know it's a lot of numbers, so I'm just going to highlight a few things. In the first column is the number of practices that had a sufficient denominator size based on a minimum of 30 for clinical quality measures and 150 for utilization and cost measures. And you'll see that the number of practices varies widely. For example, out of the 11,000 practices identified, less than 1% or 102 practices met the denominator requirement for the asthma medication ratio measure. The numbers were also very small for the child and adolescent immunization measures. And this is likely due to there being mostly adult practices and many solo practices. In contrast, for colorectal cancer screening, about 40% of the practices met the denominator requirement. In the next few columns, you'll see generally lower overall average rates and lots of variation across practices, with only a small percent meeting the National Committee for Quality Assurance commercial all lines of business 25th percentile. And this is especially true for the clinical quality measures. We're assuming this is due to incomplete data, with many of the measures relying on supplemental clinical data for accurate representation of performance. Performance on the utilization and cost measures, where claims data alone is sufficient, look much better. Next slide, please. So what did we learn? Jesse already covered some of the refinement opportunities related to the practice algorithm, so I'm going to focus on learnings and opportunities related to the practice level measurement. For CAPC, we will be focused on getting more complete clinical data for more accurate results, in particular blood pressure, childhood immunizations, and lab results. It was clear that missing clinical data affected the results. We'll consider lowering denominator requirements to balance reliability of results with the number of practices with usable results, especially for the pediatric measures. And we'll also consider including all payer types, not just commercial, to increase practice size. This would then require some type of case mix adjustment, so more methodological work would be needed, but getting results for their full panel is preferable for practices. So that's what we have for you in terms of content. Now we'd be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Great. Thank you so much for that presentation. We received a few audience questions, and I have a few questions also, so hopefully we can get through all of them. So first, can you talk a little bit more about the definition of primary care that you used for your approach, and whether it aligns with any other projects going on in the state? I know primary care is a hot topic right now, and certainly in California, there's probably other organizations or agencies thinking about it.
Yeah, I'll start out, and Jesse, feel free to chime in as well. So we used a definition of primary care based on mostly provider type. And so we used internists, GPs, FPs, and pediatricians, as well as NPs and PAs that have a primary care focus. And so we had a specific provider taxonomy code list that we used. There were some providers, like critical access hospitals or rural health centers, things like that, where there were some code restrictions, but otherwise we didn't have any primary care service requirements. It was just based on the provider taxonomy. And we were developing this at the same time that NESCO was doing their work. And so our code lists actually align completely with the NESCO code lists. So all the same. There were different definitions in both NESCO and IHA's work, but we used, like I said, the providers and all of the services that they rendered. As you mentioned, there's a lot of work going on in California right now with the Office of Healthcare Affordability. And so we are working with Freedman and others to help the Office of Healthcare Affordability and share our learnings and things like that. And ultimately, the goal is to have a single definition in California that we can use that will be. And so IHA may, kind of tweak our methodology a bit as we go through this process with the state. But definitely wanting to make sure that we have a consistent definition.
Thank you so much.
No, I think you covered it. Yes, we're trying to use established methods and using the same approach elsewhere in California, and also that we used in that was used in the NESCO project. And as you alluded to, there's several different definitions there. So, we tried to stay consistent with what's been used elsewhere.
Thank you. And Margaret from the audience asked, did you consider incorporating TINs into your attribution methodology?
Yes, we did. Unfortunately, we don't have billing TIN in our data submission guide. And so that is being added. That was one of the learnings because we found that that's what most of the plans use for primary care contracting with practices. So that was definitely a limitation of this first pilot round and one of the learnings for improvement.
Thank you. And then Kenley asked, what tools do you use to normalize and clean address data?
I'll let Jesse talk about that one.
Yeah, that's a great question. That's a tricky one. So we have in a number of different projects sort of addressed or tried to clean address data. There's a few different ways to do it. One of the approach that we've taken here, so just as a step back, all the address information that we're receiving are coming directly for this project are coming directly from MPES. The process we took was to look for specific aspects of it that we didn't want to include. So we removed things like the suite, that kind of thing, using primarily just a SQL approach where we were just trying to remove specific aspects that we didn't think that we could properly match on. So we tried to get down to the individual street address level, including the suite if we had it, but removing some of those tricky keywords that can be spelled in numerous different ways.
Thank you. And then one additional question that just came in, actually, you were talking about NPES, and maybe you can speak a little bit to the frequency of refreshes. The question from me is, what is the logic applied if a provider changes practices within a reporting period? For example, provider A changed affiliation from practice 123 to practice 124. In the final step, what practice would that provider be affiliated with?
Yeah, that's a great question. So essentially, we performed like a 2-year look back across all of the. So it's really two parts to this. So the first is for the information coming in from MPES, if they're identified with their physical address there, there's some fields in MPES that identify the dates with which a provider is attributed to a given practice. So we incorporated those. But in the logic itself, we looked at the billing NPIs that were most frequent over a 2-year period. So if someone were to switch and start billing to a particular billing NPI for just the last few months of that 2-year period, they would likely be attributed to the first billing NPI where they billed the majority of that time.
Great. Thank you. Thank you very much. I know we had another question. I would love to bring our other presenters into this since we only have about 15 minutes left. Please keep the questions coming. But I did miss an earlier question. I believe that was posed to Chris and Alice. So I wanted to go back to that. And then we had a few questions for all of our presenters. So the question for Chris and Alice, does your tool, this is the Submitter Quality Index, pick up contextual things? For example, if a submitter changes all of their member IDs between submissions, would the tool catch that?
It's not set up to catch that. It would be more if it was just like started being, they submitted blank member IDs or something of that nature, or like it wasn't long enough. Where we'd catch that if they like change all of their member IDs would be more on the some of our intake validation side.
Thank you. Thanks, Chris. Okay, I'm going to pose this question. This is for all of our presenters. In general, how did your team identify the need for the solution that you developed? How was the data gap or need first identified, and by whom? Who was part of the decision to build something? Anyone want to take a first pass at it?
I can go. For our SQI, it started actually before I started with Civic, but it was something that we identified was going to be helpful to understand, like Chris said, the overall health of the APCD data, as well as just the usability of it, how we were going to be able to inform policy, improve, you know, overall health for Coloradans with the data that we have in the APCD. So we realized that having this score was going to help us to see those areas where we could improve upon, those areas where we were, where the data is actually performing in really good areas. And then, as he also said, we want to continue to enhance it. So continue to add more logical checks, add more data elements that we see that are coming in that are being used for some of the reports and analytics that we are the data is used for. So a lot of it was based on wanting to understand, again, the overall health and usability of the data, and then make sure that it is going to be high quality to be able to inform policy for Coloradans.
Thank you. Anybody else want to talk about how they first identified the need for the solution that you described?
I can share a little bit. I think there's a lot of focus on primary care in California, and in particular, the state purchasers, so Cover California, CalPERS, and Department of Healthcare Services, really interested in understanding primary care performance. And so when we thought about what is the appropriate level to measure primary care, we thought that the practice level would be the most appropriate. We have a lot of kind of delegated organized groups in California, and IHA does a lot of measurement at that level. But when we started thinking about primary care, we thought we needed to go to a more granular level of the practice. But then we started thinking about, well, how do we know which practice a member belongs to? And how do we identify what the practices are? Because we don't necessarily have a field for that in our data submission guide. And so that's what prompted this work. Like, how can we use all the data elements that are in claims and eligibility that we do have to be able to identify practices and attribute, you know, members to PCPs and PCPs to practices? And so that's kind of what generated the interest, you know, the public purchasers and other purchasers really being interested in measuring primary care and wanting to do it at that more granular level, and then having to define, you know, kind of how do we do that? How do we get that from the data that we have?
Thank you, Dolores. Babak, I don't know if you want to comment from your perspective, or I can go to our next question, whatever you like.
Yeah, just I think very briefly for us, it happened during, because for each data call, we have a deadline and then we should submit the data set. And one thing is that unfortunately, the data set for each year of the data set, similar data set, you should put the same different in different file, and then it goes and checks against, creates an XML, then XML, then being checked against their own schema. And we thought first, it's better that we don't receive their validation check. It's better we should check it ourselves first. Reason. The second is that because we are thinking about then later on develop our own data visualization and probably an API for the users to be able to get the data. And we thought that it's better if we have developed our system, then later it can be used for our API, especially API development also. And then we came out with this solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to skip the second question I had because I think many of you answered it, talking about the KPIs that you are using to track the success of your solution, whether it's working. I'm going to move on to whether you experienced any pushback in the development of your tool or approach. Was it hard to get stakeholder buy-in? Or did everyone kind of nod in unison, yes, this thing is needed, go for it?
For the SQI, we had total buy-in, so there was really no pushback, which was very nice. We just made it clear what we were checking for the fields and our methodology, and it was very, very well received.
How wonderful. That's awesome to hear. Thanks. Others?
Yeah, I'll chime in. You know, I think that we had broad agreement on the need for this kind of work. The challenge was getting agreement, you know, making sure that what we came up with the algorithm actually matched the provider rosters so that it kind of rung true. So I think it was had a lot of stakeholder buy-in, just like working through the details of the methodology where, you know, that was pretty challenging. And I will say that when we presented the results to our CAPC group, you know, one of the suggestions that they had was that really the primary relationship is not so much member to PCP in this case, but member to practice and making sure the member is attributed to the proper practice. And so starting with that, and then within the practice, you know, kind of looking at which PCP they saw the most. So kind of flipping the order. And then that would also allow for a PCP to be part of more than one practice. And so I think, you know, kind of through the process and then through seeing what the results looked like, now we have some really great suggestions for how we can enhance the algorithm going forward and really make sure that it's going to fit the use case, which is, you know, using it to actually as part of a payment model for paying primary care practices. And so wanting to make sure you get the right members attributed. So anyway, I think it's been a really great process, both the methodological development, but then actually using it for measurement, seeing what the results were and vetting it with our CAPC group and now having, you know, more suggestions for how to move forward with it.
Yeah, and just one additional note there. I think it was really, you know, we built in the stakeholder group feedback mechanism right from the very beginning so that we could be upfront and then gauge feedback about what our methodology was, what the approach was, what our findings were for exactly this reason, that it's a challenge. And we want to make sure that we're very transparent about what our methodology is and make everyone aware of all the caveats and nuances, things like that. And it was really helpful getting their feedback at several points throughout the process. So I think having a stakeholder group who was engaged throughout the process was a really important part of our methodology development.
Thank you. I'm looking at our Q&A. We have a question that came in for Babak from Ginny. Is the validation library available for others to use? You mentioned it's on GitHub, and how do we get it? How do we get access?
Yes, it's on GitHub. Yeah, I can share the GitHub address maybe here. And I would be very happy to receive all the, because as I said, it's a work in progress and we are developing it more, and I would be happy to receive any comments on that. So I'm going to share the address here.
Thank you. And I believe, I'm not an expert on this platform yet, but I believe that your contact information is available if you scroll down, or certainly in other places. And so hopefully if you aren't able to access the link that Babak shares now, you can reach out to him directly. One other question that was received from the audience, I believe, Dolores, this is to you and Jesse, was from Denise. I think this is, again, your primary care methodology. Many area COBs providing primary care services. Was this considered?
Yeah, we did consider it. It actually is one of the definitions. There's four different definitions, but for the work that we have been doing, we've not been including OBGYNs. When we think about primary care spending, we actually did include OBGYN services rendered by what we consider to be PCPs, but the OBGYNs themselves, we did not include as PCPs.
Thank you. All right. Well, those are the questions that we received. I think we've gotten through all of them. I want to thank our presenters, our wonderful presenters again, for taking the time to put these presentations together and share your lessons learned and your approaches to these tasks. This was wonderful. Hopefully everybody enjoyed it. And if people have follow-up questions, please reach out to the presenters directly. Thank you all for joining us.
Thanks. Bye, everyone.